MMA stands for mixed martial arts, and typically mixed martial arts represents a combination of striking and grappling. You could say the three main disciplines of which that is composed of would be Muay Thai, wrestling, and jiu-jitsu. But there's variations of different types of striking. Of course, Muay Thai is our base style. Wrestling represents a takedown or going to the ground or not. And then the submission game is typically represented by the term jiu-jitsu. Become a leader first, you become a good follower. So I was a student first and with various instructors, and I tried to learn well. And after time comes, and you know, I continued through the ranks in some respects, and I guess after about 10 years or so, I had the opportunity to become partners with one of my teachers, and that's when I officially started teaching full-time. I've been teaching professionally for 22 years. I've been doing martial arts for about 32 years. I started competing, you know, when I was young, I don't know, maybe 16-ish. And I competed in a variety of different things, from karate, kickboxing, it was called PKA, WKA, Muay Thai, shoot boxing, sabaki, which is like bare knuckle, and jiu-jitsu, and then I went to Pankratian and mixed martial arts.
I've always liked martial arts and martial arts movies, so I started at a young age. So I just kept going with it and turned out I was pretty good at it. MMA is not really violent. I mean, I don't consider myself a fighter, it's just people competing. So to me, it's just competition, right? It's like playing basketball, but you get to punch each other in the face, I guess.
I know his strengths and his weaknesses, so I can focus on his weaknesses. Also, cueing on different techniques is pretty easy, since every technique is very tactical as to how the body is and how the position. I always think that you need to be in a stronger position to be able to create maximal force and also to protect the joints.
Training gets, you know, it gets kind of repetitive after a while, but, you know, they're good at bringing you guys in and, you know, training you in different aspects of the game so that you're never really bored. For the most part, yeah, it's pretty hard, but you just gotta have a lot of dedication.
We haven't had a discrimination training because I'd say anything that any conflicting ideas, we both on both ends will explain why we don't feel the same thoughts on it, and usually we can kind of figure out why and explain it so that we figure out why we're doing something or why we shouldn't do something. So it makes sense in the end. It's just basically finding out the background information as to why and why you can't do certain movements, and just train a thought on that discussion.
I guess just a lot of time. Like, I've given up a lot of time with, you know, my loved ones, my friends and family. But like, other than that, I just, you know, just a lot of time that I've given up.
The goal for them is for them to achieve their potential, whatever that may be. So again, traditionally speaking, I guess the goals are, you know, learn, acquire some self-defense skills, be in good shape, learn some mental discipline. If they wish to be sporting, then of course we do that. So the goal would be, I guess, to how would I say it? try to achieve excellence in whatever area they choose. So whether that expectation is realized, I don't know. Sometimes it is. I'd say my ratios of realizations to not are probably quite good. I would always like to improve my numbers as far as number of students who are doing excellently and achieving their potential. But so that's the goal. That is the goal of what I teach or how I've been taught, and so I continue in that method.